Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Okay, we're ready to begin. I'd like to start off by welcoming everyone to this morning's meeting. It's nice to see a full house. Before we begin our official agenda, I'd like to ask Commissioner Sutton to give us our invocation.
We can have a moment, please. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for another spring morning. Thank you for all the rain that we've had this spring. We desperately needed it. Please let it flow into the summer. Be with us this morning as we deliberate and discuss the county's business. Be with us as we have to make decisions in regards to our upcoming budget. Our Heavenly Father, there are people in this room, including myself and others in our community and around the world, that need your blessings, need your help, need your miracles. Please try to get it on our minds as to the association that we need to have with you. Please be with our troops worldwide and in our country. Please help our nation's attempt to defeat terrorism around the world. Amen.
Amen. Under our public comments section this morning, I'd like to introduce Keith Quitted, who's chair of our local health department board, for an introduction.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Board of County Commissioners. You know, as your Board of Health, the state law requires us to hire your health director. And since last October, when we lost the last one, and Tim Green has filled in as your interim health director, we've searched a long time, and we think we have found a good health director for you. I'd like to introduce you to you this morning, Barry Bass. Barry, come up if you will. Barry has had a lot of experience as a health director, 24 years, the last 10 of which has been in Davie County. He's a former health director of the year in the state of North Carolina and has served on many boards in the state. We believe that we've found a good health director for you. And with the board, the health board, we'd like to thank Commissioner Lashley, who's worked tirelessly with us, and also the county manager, and Mr. Smith, and Joyce Hinton Graves, your personnel director, who's helped us bring Barry to your staff. He will become your health director effective July the 1st, 2008. And the statute says that that you folks, as county commissioners, consult with us to hire your health director. And so we'd like to have you ask him any questions that you have for him, or and just seek your blessings on his hire. So Barry Bass.
Okay, welcome, Barry.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, sir.
Glad to have you in Alamance County.
Well, we're glad to be here, and certainly going to be my privilege to work for this board, to work for you folks and all the good citizens of this county, and hopefully what I lack in beauty and grace, I can make up for charm and wit. So I sincerely look forward to working with you all, and hopefully can bring to you a lot of the skills, abilities that I have, and the experience, and make it to be the best health department in the state of North Carolina.
Okay.
Look forward. Certainly, it's a pleasure to have you, Barry.
Yes, sir, absolutely. I'm glad to be here.
Okay. Welcome.
Thank you.
All right.
Thanks, Barry.
Let me add to Mr. Bass. The health board has been looking for somebody to replace Tim Green for the past several months, and it's a pleasure to welcome Barry as the new health department director. He's going to be an asset to the county and to the health department. We're pleased to have you.
Yeah, thank you, Bill. I also appreciate Tim Green's efforts in filling in while we were looking for a new health director. Thank you, Tim.
It's going to be hard to replace Tim.
I see he's in there.
Thank you, Tim.
Good to see.
Appreciate it.
Also, we have another introduction. I'd like to call on our planning director, Jason. You want to make an introduction?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, I'd like to just take this time to formally introduce our new planner. I think everybody has met him privately, but Christopher Ong started with us in March, I believe it was, and he comes to us from the University of North Carolina, Greensboro, where he's working on his master's in public affairs, concentrating in community and economic development, which is a little bit of a soft spot for me, being that it's kind of similar to my background. So, but I did want to just welcome him and make a formal introduction to everybody.
Good.
Glad to have you.
Also glad to have you on board.
Thank you.
Okay, next we'll get into the heart of the agenda, which is fairly short this morning.
Yeah.
We'll begin with the Emergency Medical Service Program of Dr. Christopher Granger, the Medical Director at Duke Medical Center. Dr. Granger?
Good morning, and it's a real pleasure of mine to be here today to talk about something that we're really proud of and that we think is really important, and to have the chance to discuss with you, in a broad sense, the importance of emergency medical services and in appropriate resourcing of emergency medical services as we deal with this type of a problem. And I'm specifically today talking about heart disease, coronary heart disease, the number one killer in the U.S. and worldwide, and its acute manifestation heart attacks. And we have recognized a few years ago that there are highly effective ways to save lives of people who have heart attacks, which are caused by a blockage of the blood vessel, an interruption of the blood flow to the heart muscle. And if that blocked artery can be opened quickly, we can save lives. And we have the ability now to open arteries quickly. We recognize, though, that in the United States, and particularly in North Carolina, that there is a problem with not opening arteries quickly enough and in as many patients as we should be. So we embarked on a project called the RACE Project. It stands for Reperfusion of Acute MI in Carolina Emergency Departments. And in fact, Alamance County has always been a key part of this. In fact, one of our flagship communities in dealing with this. And I would suggest that in medicine, and we at the Duke Clinical Research Institute have been involved with a lot of these programs, that we've made great advances in understanding what treatments work. And now a big challenge that we've got is better applying those to save lives and to improve public health. And so our objective in this program then was to reduce the number of patients who aren't being treated with these life-saving treatments, to improve the speed of treatment, to establish regional systems of care of heart attacks that include emergency medical services, emergency departments, and cath labs and hospitals, and a lot of training of emergency medical personnel in doing this. We were fortunate to have a lot of support in this project from a number of groups, including Blue Cross Blue Shield provided us with a generous grant as we started out with this, and other groups, including the professional societies, the American College of Cardiology, the American Heart Association, and emergency medical services groups as well. And we published the results of our project last year in the Journal of the American Medical Association. And the way we designed this project was to have five regions across the state of North Carolina, each that had centers that were highly specialized, that had primary angioplasty, that could open arteries with balloon catheters. And then each of these regions also had other hospitals that might use blood clot dissolving medicines or transfer patients with heart attack to the primary angioplasty centers. I would like to focus on emergency medical services, though, as really being the key to what we're doing. And the fact that, and this is not, in fact, I think you have questions about the opposite issue in Alamance County, but across our country, I think EMS has been grossly underappreciated and underfunded and undersupported in what we're trying to do with dealing with healthcare in our country, and specifically with heart disease, and that we need to have, you know, this is an example of a sign from an eastern county, from a coastal county in North Carolina, where there's even more of an issue in this area, where literally there have to be these fundraising efforts to get adequate funding for emergency medical services to do their job. Here's another, I think, kind of striking issue for us to deal with, and that is if you just look at kind of current publicly available descriptions of funding sources, you see that the garbage collection is substantially better funded than even fairly highly trained paramedics, again, across our country. And I think this is embarrassing, that here we have people who are critical to saving lives for patients who have heart disease, who have heart attacks. There are foot soldiers in the battle against heart disease, and yet we tend to underfund them compared to other other issues in our society. So what we did then is we took these five regions. We had worked with every EMS system, every emergency department to develop better and faster ways to identify and more quickly treat patients with heart attack. And we brought the average time to treating heart attacks down for patients who are being transferred, for example, down from about 160 minutes down to about 105 minutes for treating patients with heart attack, which translates into many lives being saved. So we proved that this could happen. We focused on EMS, on using pre-hospital EKGs, on calling hospitals to activate this process of opening the artery as early as possible when a patient with heart attack was identified. And all of our times were improved. And so that we believe that this type of a program should serve as an example for the nation on how this can be done. And we now believe that if you need to have a heart attack, that North Carolina is one of the best places in the country to have one. And in fact, Alamance County is one of the best counties in the country to have a heart attack. And this has been adopted now by other groups. There's a huge program from the American College of Cardiology that's working on improving timely treatment with angioplasty. And the American Heart Association has used our program in North Carolina to establish a national program of trying to improve heart attack care. And again, I'll just reiterate that I think the role that paramedics, that emergency directors like Dr. Kaminsky play in this role are absolutely critical. And in fact, again, I know there are these issues that you're up against about, you know, what is the value, how do you fund it, how much should you put into it. But what I can tell you as somebody who treats these patients every day, that what you're doing in establishing a world-class EMS group here in Alamance County is of tremendous value to the people of Alamance County. And let me ask Jenny Underwood, who's been our regional coordinator, who is a critical care nurse and really has organized what we're doing in this part of North Carolina, to make a couple of other brief comments about what she's done.
So I just wanted to talk more specifically about what's been going on here in Alamance County over the last 2.5 years. So this is all really relevant to the state of North Carolina, but what have we done in Alamance County to improve patient care? Those patients having heart attacks. And sort of, this is, there's actually a much, much longer list, and I tried to narrow it down as much as I could. But the very first thing that you guys, I know, have supported is funding for 12-lead ECG equipment. And there is still about 30% of the state, of the counties in the state, that don't have 12-lead EKG equipment at all. So by your support of funding 12-lead ECG equipment on the truck, patients' lives are being saved. The other thing is education, ongoing interpretation of EKGs. These paramedics, a job that was previously reserved for emergency department physicians, and that is diagnosing an acute MI by looking at the EKG, that privilege has now been given to your paramedics. We've spent hundreds of hours training them to read 12-lead EKGs, and they can now literally activate the Duke Cath Lab, talk to a cardiologist, and have about 10 people come in from home at 2 in the morning so that the cath lab staff is there and ready to meet the patient so they can work on opening the artery. Field activation, so again, these patients can go directly from their home into the cath lab. They don't stop in the emergency department. They go straight upstairs. They know all about acute MI care here in Alamance County. Every EMT paramedic can tell you all about acute MI care and what the best current treatments are for these patients. And then the other thing that we've been working with them on is feedback. So every patient that comes from Alamance County to Duke or Moses Cone or UNC or Alamance Regional, gets immediate feedback on how their performance was. So how long did they spend at the bedside? How long did it take to get that 12-lead EKG? Because with heart attacks, the most critical thing is time. And then finally, the ongoing support of Dr. Kaminsky, as Dr. Granger mentioned, Chuck Mansells, and Connie Collins has just been phenomenal. This county, for me, I worked with 10 counties over the last 2 years. For me, this county has been the easiest, most eager to learn, most receptive to trying to improve patient care. And so these are the things that have been happening in Alamance County. And then this, just to give you some idea of how many patients we're talking about, there are three different types of heart attacks, and we're actually just talking about one specific kind of heart attack, and that's the one, that, again, that's really time sensitive to having the artery open. And so in February of March of last year, we did lots of training, got the paramedics up to speed on how to use their 12-lead EKG equipment, how to interpret EKGs, how to call an acute MI hotline and activate the cath lab. And these are the number of patients each quarter that have been brought directly from home to the Duke cath lab and have had what we call a door-to-balloon time. So from the time they hit the emergency department door at Duke until the time their artery was opened in the cath lab was less than 45 minutes, which is phenomenal. It's really phenomenal, better than anybody else in the state, actually. And then finally, I just wanted to give you an example of the type of feedback that we give to the paramedics on every single acute MI that comes in. So this was a 75-year-old white male. He came in on the 6th of March of this year. He had chest pain that started at 9 o'clock. He called the paramedics. Paramedics were at his home at 11:32 and got his 12-lead. Called the acute MI hotline at Duke. You can see he arrived in the emergency department at Duke at 12:29. Pretty much went straight up to the cath lab. He spent 5 minutes in the Duke ER for a rapid registration and went straight up to the cath lab. The cath lab staff was there and ready to meet him. They were able to deploy the balloon at 13:05. And so we like to look at that very bottom number, that door to device number, meaning the time, again, that he hit the emergency department door at Duke until the time his artery was open was 36 minutes. And this gentleman who previously could have been dead had we waited an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours. The type of heart attack he had was very serious. Went home 2 days later, and this is one example of many. And we'd like to entertain any questions if possible.
This is certainly great news to know how well prepared we are here. Can
you explain the difference between the different types of heart attacks?
Yeah. The type of heart attack we're talking about is a type where the artery is completely blocked, and that's called the term we use for that is ST elevation heart attack, which is something on the EKG that shows us that the artery is totally blocked, and that's the one that needs to have the artery open. Then there's another generally smaller type of heart attack where the EKG doesn't have that pattern, where the artery may be opening and closing, but it's generally not completely blocked, and for that we just use blood thinning medicines. And a more delayed type of heart cath and angioplasty is generally the best treatment.
How do heart attacks differ in men and women?
There are important differences in men and women. Generally, in women, women are less likely to have typical symptoms of chest pain. So this type of a program may be even more important for women because in women, sometimes we tend to miss the fact that they're having a heart attack. It may just be shortness of breath or indigestion rather than real chest pain.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Chuck, is Chuck here?
Yeah, he's over here.
Yeah, Chuck. Is Dr. Gaminsky here? Yeah. Y'all have any comments?
This is obviously an important part of patient care in Alamance County. Is one part of what EMS does. I'm very proud of the paramedics. One thing that I'd like to say is we've made a switch in terms of how the paramedics can respond to these STEMI heart attacks. And previously, they always brought them to Alamance Regional, which where I work primarily, in the fine facility, but we do not have emergent PCI capability. We can't do that catheterization right away. So we would put them right back in the ambulance and send them to Duke, which wasted time. Having our paramedics trained to take them straight to Duke and activate the cath lab having earned the respect of the staff at Duke. It means so much in terms of the care of the patient. But the I'd like to give credit where credit is due. It was about 2 years ago where we said, all right, paramedics can do the interpretation and take the patient to the appropriate facility. And I like to say, I gave them a foot and they took a yard. And paramedics have done an incredible job taking the freedom that we've given them and doing the right thing for the patient. And I can't applaud the crew enough, the Broad Ranch Food Corps Awards for Alamance and the best.
Congratulations to you and your staff, Joe.
Thanks, sir.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
Thank you very much.
Next, we have the county manager.
Here comes my heart attack.
You got to do way around.
Yeah, hold on.
That's why I want to know the difference. Okay.
All doctors wait around.
Thank you.
That's a little weekend reading for you. This is the third budget that I have presented to you, and it will be my last budget to present to you. The first budget 2 years ago, I asked for a 1.5 cent increase in the property tax, and you voted a 1.25% increase in the property tax. Last year I asked for a 0.5 cent increase in the property tax, and that's what you voted. This year I'm asking for no increase in the property tax for the 09 budget. I want to thank Amy and her staff, especially Susan Roberts and Tim Burgess, who all worked very hard in preparing this budget for you. The total budget for 2009 for Alamance County is $147,678,178. Total operating budget is $129,676,438. This year, the operating budget was $127,227,759, and the tax rate will remain at 58 cents. We will be using $2.27 million in fund balance to balance this budget, which is $700,000 less than we used last year. I intentionally tried to lower the amount of fund balance because the auditors had made a statement that we needed to start doing that, and so that's what I did intend to do. We didn't lower it as much as I would like to, but lowered it as much as we thought that we could, and continue the services at the same level that you've been providing to the citizens here in the county. The budget includes a 2.5% pay raise for employees. It also includes career ladders for certain departments, fairly critical departments. the sheriff's deputies, sheriff's school resource officers, the sheriff's jail detention officers, all are included in this budget for a career ladder. Social services has submitted, and we are recommending a career ladder for their social workers, for child support workers, and for the income maintenance workers. All of these particular departments, we are having problems retaining employees in these departments, whether it's stress, overwork, a heavy caseload, whatever it is. We're still having trouble retaining these people. We're also having trouble filling a lot of these slots because of the pay, for one thing, in addition to the stress that many of them require. Also, and this is very important, effective July 1 of this year in the budget, new hires, new employees, will no longer receive health insurance when they retire. Everyone up through June 30 will continue to receive their retirement health insurance. At that point, it's just a situation that in the future, I perceive, and I think most experts perceive, will be extremely costly to the county. This year it was $1.8 million, and we are implementing a new program that will help that, but there's no guarantee that that program will last more than 1 year. We certainly hope that it will, but we cannot in all good conscience put this burden on the taxpayers of Alamance County. Now, a lot of the counties do have it, but other counties are starting to eliminate it. Most private industry does not pay this anymore. So it is a great benefit to the employees, but it's a benefit that I don't think the county is going to be able to afford in the future. The budget book that you have before you is a lot larger and includes a lot more information than we have given you in the past. If you recall, the last year's budget book was very thin. This one has about any information you want on Alamance County, financial information you can possibly want. Now, you may have trouble finding it at first, so if you do, call Amy's department or call me, and we'll be glad to direct you to what you're looking for. You'll notice that the budget message is in there, followed by the budget ordinance, the general fund summary, that's the revenues and expenditures for the county, the fire district's fund summary, schools capital reserve fund, followed by county buildings capital reserve fund. There's the emergency telephone fund, which is your 911 fund, the landfill fund, the employees insurance. As you know, the county is self-insured for health insurance. We're also self-insured for workers' comp. That fund is also included. Then we have the department budgets. This is a line item for each department in the county, followed by salary information. And we put in the back some historical information for you about the financial history of Alamance County. I think it should be extremely informative to you. Now, rather than go through the entire budget, which you, of course, can read, I would like to highlight some of it by going over the budget for our larger departments. Department of Social Services, we're cutting $717,284 out of last year's budget or this year's budget, and even by doing that, we were able to include the career ladder for three of the DSS departments. The sheriff's department, we cut five of the 10 vehicles that the sheriff was allocated this year. And the sheriff did not ask for very much in his budget over this present year's budget. The career ladders for his deputies, his SROs, and the detention officers are included. And the jail budget, we made no cuts at all. And let me say about the jail budget. We are asking the sheriff to bring in $6 million in revenue in the new budget. He tells me, and Amy says, we're pretty well on track to bringing in $5 to $6 million this year. So we don't know what it'll be exactly, but he is billing about $400,000 to $500,000 a month at the present time. And if we can continue that, then we should be all right on revenue for the new budget. And people need to understand that this has not been done in the county in the past. $6 million of revenue coming into the jail is an awesome amount. It is taking a lot of additional employees, and people don't understand that you cannot handle 500 inmates with the same staff that you had when you were didn't have the new part of our jail. There's just no way. And the burden on the jail people and the sheriff is tremendous to do that. We basically have quite a gem over here as far as the jail is concerned. Look around the counties around Alamance County. Guilford County has got a bond to try to raise $110 million to build a jail. $110 million. And we have held some of the Guilford County prisoners in the past. So jail space is a premium, at a premium in throughout the entire state. Health department, we cut $231,864 out of this year's budget. EMS, we cut one SUV and one ambulance. Revenue has been the real question for a couple of months, and there's been a lot of confusion about the revenue figures. In this budget, we are projecting a total revenue of $127,285,338. And to that, we have to add our fund balance of $2.7 million. The hiring freeze. This is a fairly delicate budget, commissioners, in that there are certain things that we did to try to keep the tax rate the same. You can't do it by just wishing that it can be done. In the budget, we are holding the hiring freeze on 48 positions through December 31 of this year. That will save us almost $1 million, $869,962 to be exact. And again, as far as revenue, we are asking the sheriff to bring in $6 million from the jail. Our sales tax projection is down 8.16% from this year. We lose Articles 44 and 39 because of the Medicaid compromise. Property tax. We are projecting a $918,000 increase in our property tax in this new budget. That is $2.8 million this year. The increase we had this year. So we're projecting about a $2 million or $1.9 million decrease in our property tax. And that is primarily due to the devaluation of the utilities property, which the state comes in and does every 4 years. Let me just give you some figures, fairly recent figures, for the first 4 months of 2008. Our building permits, and this is just since January 1 of this year. New single family residences are down 41%. Permits issued are down 19%. Revenue collected down 21%. Construction costs down 20%. Now, these are the figures that I saw before I advised you that we're going to have a revenue, could have a revenue shortfall in the coming year. Not this year. We're okay this year. But we have to be cautious in the new budget. That's one of the reasons I tried to hold the line and not ask for any increase. And I know there's sentiment on the board for a decrease, and I wish to goodness that we could have a decrease in the taxes.
Well, I think we can have a decrease in the taxes. We, just because you're presenting this to us, don't mean that we're going to accept it.
Yes, sir. I understand, Commissioner. Schools. Total appropriation for the schools, $34,313,214. This year, our total appropriation is $31,532,514. An 8.8% increase in the new budget over the present year. The school system requested this year $36,777,324, which was over last year's or the present year's $31,532,000. We are requesting that the board increase this year's $2.8 million, which is 53% of the school's request. You will note that the total increase in the entire county budget is due to the increase in the school's budget. 2.8%.
Would you say that again?
The total increase for this year's, the coming year's budget, is due entirely to the increase in the school's budget. Almost $2.8 million.
Does that include a supplement increase?
Yes, sir, it does. It does include a 1% supplemental increase for the teachers. It also includes this, and I'm hoping the schools will work with us on this, in that we are projecting a 10% increase in teacher pay from the state. Now, those are the figures we were given. We certainly hope that the teachers will get a 10% increase in their pay from the state, and we are going to asking you to appropriate that amount. If in fact, and I doubt that they will get 10%, but if in fact they do not get 10%, I'm hoping the school in good faith will take that extra money which the county is giving them and put it into their capital reserve fund and use that at that point. Again, hopefully the teachers will get that 10%, but if not, hopefully they'll use that money as we ask them to. Let me also add that the total, if we include the debt service that the county pays on the school bonds, the total amount of appropriation for schools in Alamance County is almost $41 million. $41 million, that's about 31 to 32% of our operating budget. Alamance Community College, total appropriation to ACC is $2,863,266. Last year, you appropriated $2,000,000, $675,000. We're asking you for a 7% increase over this year. Their total request was $2,953,000. Now, there have been statements that I'm opposed personally to the school system, to education, and because of the three-year budgets that I have presented, we have not given the schools as much as they needed, as much as they liked. I went through the Burlington system. My brother and two sisters went through the Burlington system. My one sister taught and retired after 30 years in the system. My grandchildren are going through the system. I served 8 years on the Board of Trustees for ACC. I'm not opposed to education, and I certainly do wish that we could afford to give the schools and ACC more money. But in presenting the budget to you, I have to take everything into consideration, not just the schools, but the retirees, the elderly, everybody else. And it's a balancing act, and I have talked with each of you for the last several months, and you've indicated to me exactly what you wanted or would like to have, and many times there are conflicts in what each of you may want. And taking that into consideration, we come up with what we think is a compromise. All of politics and all of government is a compromise. This budget may not satisfy any one of you completely. Certainly not perfect, but I think in its final concept, it is fair, and it can work. Again, the departments and these department heads who are here today have done an outstanding job in holding down cost in this county, because they are basically getting no increase over last year, even a cost of living increase in their expenses. They're not getting that. They're holding the line. The outside organizations are the organizations that really cause the stress and the pencil biting, really, because it takes a long time to decide where you have to cut and where you think you can cut and still let those outside agencies provide the services that they need to provide. In addition to the budget that you have before us, there are some other matters that you have already heard of. The $8 to $9 million cost for capital improvements in the county is going to be coming to you within the month, and how that can be funded. That is not included in this budget. Let me also bring, I sent you some information. Judge J.B. Allen sent me a letter from the state concerning the possibility of a public defender's office for Alamance County. Now, the figures you saw in the newspaper are the state's figures, but you are going to have to provide the space for the public defender's office, and they're going to be entitled to everything that the district attorney has, and a minimum of 5,000 square feet. 5,000 square feet at the present going rate is going to cost us about $60,000 a year just to give them the space. You're going to have to buy the equipment. They're going to be entitled to the same kind of equipment that the DA is entitled to. So the total cost was not in the paper. The total cost is going to be a lot greater than the state wants you to believe. You need to also know that in the future, there will have to be tax increases. We'll be doing the revaluation next year. The law requires that you seek revenue neutral and determine revenue neutral, which means that the increase in valuation, and you determine exactly how much it will take to raise the same amount of money, which is about $61 million. You will have a decrease in the tax rate, but people's taxes will not go down. So to cover the items that the public is going to demand, including the schools, you will have to raise taxes in the future. Quite frankly, there were too many things left undone in the past that you are going to be faced with repairing and improving. I think the county is in great shape. You have an outstanding group of department heads who work really hard for you. So if you have any questions, I'd be glad to answer them.
Could you elaborate on the 8% sales tax reduction or estimate, and how much of that is anticipated retail?
Well, a lot of that is the loss of the two
of the Medicaid.
Yes, sir.
Okay, all right.
And that's the primary loss right there that we.
What's the dollar amount of that 8% of the revenues?
Do you have a dollar amount?
Amy? Are you talking, Mr. Sutton, about what we're going to lose?
Or the total? Right.
What you're going to lose?
The state, what we're figuring, is $2.6 million. And we did also include in there, we actually increased the sales tax 2%, but then taking what the state's going to take,
right,
you know, away from it, that's where we're coming up with the 8.16% decrease.
What's the gross 2%? Is that, was that $5
million? No, it's only... $546,000.
No, I'm talking about what did we estimate the growth in sales tax to be with that Medicaid issue to the side? In other words, don't we?
We usually went 3 to 4%.
Okay, what's 3 to 4% of what we normally get in sales tax?
You got that, Amy?
Because from that's where we subtract out the 2.6.
Right.
Okay. All right.
Well, no, we only increased it. We only increased it this year 2% rather than our regular 4% or 3%.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
All right.
Because so of the slowdown in the economy.
Because of the economy,
right.
Yes.
You believe that's going to be the case, right?
Yes.
Okay. I still would like to see what we have as a gross figure. And that's fine. We can get that later. On the utilities issue here, I have seen that figure go from $1 million to $2 million in less than 2 weeks as far as the estimated loss. Can you just in real lay terms for me, what did we get this year in the utilities, in the taxation on the utilities versus what we're expecting in dollars on the utilities?
The state tells us, we don't do it ourselves. The state tells us what their depreciation is going to be and what we have to decrease our revenue projections for.
Right.
Unless Amy's got them, I don't have them in my head or in the information here. I can get them.
Right. Yeah. I like to see, and I like to see how that's done. Like overall estimate of what they had as the evaluation this year versus what we anticipated to be this upcoming year.
During the 4-year period, I guess they get a regular depreciation, but that fourth year they get a larger depreciation on the value of their personal and real property or personal property. And they have an awful lot of personal property, of course.
Well, I'd like to see, and I think all the commissioners need to see, we need to be honest with our vote here when we have our budget vote. If we're going to lose $2 million there, I want to see it. Again, 2 weeks ago, it was $1
million. Well, I don't know where you got the million. I've never.
That was the first figure that I heard initially, that we were going to lose $1 million in revenue due to that situation.
I think it's about 1.8, isn't it, Amy?
And now I'm hearing 2. And that's why I'm asking to see this broke down to where I can understand it and read it, other than just having somebody tell me.
We'll get there.
If you will.
Yes, sir.
Because that's a big key point. That's 2 cents on the tax rate.
Oh, it is. 2 cents.
Yes, sir. And that's double what 1 cent was when I first heard the quote. I'd like to bring out something. I really wasn't going to mention it this morning, but in today's paper, and Tom's here, and I hope Tom can help me. Were you at the forum yesterday in Elon? Okay. Was there an overall statement made that we were at the bottom when it came to funding for the schools?
No, sir. There were a couple of comments made, and the statistics were given. Alamance County, on a per pupil funding from the county level, Dr. Bridges, correct me if I'm wrong, but we're 45th out of 100 counties.
Right.
The statement that was probably alluded to in the paper, Mr. Boyer was there, at the state level, the per pupil funding for Alamance County is 111th out of 115th. But that's because the state delivers the money to the school system based on the allocation for the teachers.
Right.
The teachers are paid based on the number of years' experience, their highest degree. If we have a relatively new teaching force, which we do, then that would lend itself to lower funding at the state.
Right. I think you're alluding to this sheet here. Well, the overall statement that I saw in the paper, unless I misread it, was would make people believe that we were at the bottom with per pupil funding at the local level.
The local level is 45th.
Right.
The state's 111th. I think the weighted comes in.
But the state, the paper didn't have that. That's what I'm trying to get at.
46, didn't it, Tom?
45th.
Right. I'm looking at this 46. Chart right now.
Yeah, 46.
The state is, we're ranked 111.
Yes.
The federal, we're ranked 96, but the local is 46.
Yeah.
Okay, and I asked 2 years ago why that was the way it was, and I think I got a letter about it, but I still didn't understand it. And this is something that I think is very important to understand. This is, I don't want anything I say to be perceived as anti-funding, anti-giving more, anti-anything. I'm just stating what I perceive to be the facts. And I just don't believe the public gets told this. In Raleigh, there's a group called the Public School Forum. And believe me, they are 100% in support of adequate funding for public schools in the state of North Carolina. I don't think there's any question about it. And they produce a report every year. We used to get a copy of this report, but I haven't seen one in the last couple of years. But the latest one that I've gotten a copy of, and I want to credit the school system for getting it to me, was the 2007 report, 2007 local study finance, local school finance study. They have three charts that are very key in looking at how to analyze the efforts across the state with each system. The first chart is the ability to pay. Now, with the ability to pay chart, they show us, they consider revenues, they consider evaluations. They really, I'm not sure if they take into consideration the amount of debt that we have for other scenarios other than the schools, they may. But they have us ranked as 45th with our ability, okay, 45th. And if you go to actual effort, that's showing what we actually are doing at per pupil funding or local funding, we're ranked 44th. So we're actually, according to this, we're in a better ranking scenario versus our ability versus what we're actually doing. And that's what I wanted to bring out, because I honestly think that a lot of these figures just don't get told. A lot of people would have you believe that we're at the bottom with our efforts, but now, I'd like to ask one more question, and I'm not going to elaborate on it right now, but I do want to ask why we have school officials here. Who sets the bar for, what's the word here, I want to see, for performance of students in each course of the ABC's end of course test? Who sets the bar for the grade level? In other words, when they state what percentage of students have exceeded grade level, is that a statewide grade level interpretation, or?
Well, Dr. Bridges, let me ask you to.
It's established by the State Board of Education.
So grade level for Guilford County is the same as grade level is for us. Is that what you're saying? Would that be accurate?
Tell me a little bit more what you mean when you say grade level.
Well, on DPI's website, they have each school system broken down as to how they did with the end of grade testing. Like, I think the latest report, there's seven tests that are geared, and they'll show that what the state grade level is, and then they'll show what percentage of your students who took that test exceeded state, or you can deduct how many didn't, what percentage didn't. And I'm just trying to see who establishes the bar for grade level and you say overall it's the state, right? So Guilford County, I'm trying to make one point here. Guilford County's bar for grade level is the same as our bar is over here as far as what we're trying to achieve. Is that, maybe I'm being rambling here with it, but I mean, our objectives for grade level would be the same as theirs. Is that correct?
The objectives and what you're trying to accomplish with passing the test, yes. But right. there's a difference. Obviously, the kids in Guilford County, the kids in Alamance County, or the kids in Wake County, you can't put them all into the same criteria. I mean,
are the tests the same?
Oh, yeah. Well,
the tests are the same and the bars
sure.
the same.
Sure.
Okay, that's what I'm trying to get at. And something that totally shocked me was I picked up Page High School the other day. This was, they had stacks of these out on their credenza as I walked out. And they had how Guilford County had done with end of grade testing. And those tests are in English, Algebra 1, Algebra 2, Geometry, Biology, Civics, and Economics, and U.S. History. They didn't have Chemistry for some reason, Physical Science, and Physics like they'd had in the past. But we do better than Guilford on as far as percentile students who, according to this, we do better than Guilford does on end of grade testing. We constantly hear money is given the results. But in that one comparison, I was shocked to see that Guilford County, that we beat them in every category, not barely, but we did, according to what DPI has on their website. With all the extra money that they've got per pupil, we're doing better than they are here, and I congratulate us for that. That they're doing better, we're doing better than they are as far as results on end of grade testing, percentile versus who exceeded state versus who didn't. And that's just one point I want to make. And I have other points I want to make about how we're doing later in regards to systems that I consider to be our peers across the state, and I'll talk about that more later.
We need to set a public hearing on this budget, proposed budget, and my recommendation would be at our third meeting this month at 7 p.m.
Second meeting on the third Monday.
May 19th.
Right. And that's what date is it?
May 19th.
May 19th at 7 p.m. So I'll propose that as a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a second. Any further discussion? Not all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carried.
Between now and then, your question is called for you.
Don't wait till the weekend. Just do it now.
Yes. We know
Thank
how to.
You.
We know how to get you. Next is the consent agenda. I move that items A through F be approved unless one commissioner would like to pull one of those out. We have a second.
Second.
Any discussion? Not all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed. Motion carried. Any announcements? Not. Again, thanks everyone for attending. Meeting's adjourned.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m. and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioner's website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Friday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 3 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.